thanks a lot for taking time for this interview and for your excellent talk yesterday. Thank you. Set the scene to the conference. So in your talk, you questioned the idea that the path to making sense of mental illness lies through the brain. Could you expand on that?
Yes, I think one has to start from asking what mental illness is. A mental illness is, to be very simple about it, an experience of a human being living in a society, conducting their everyday life. Now, if one thinks about that as the thing that one is trying to explain, then the question is, what kinds of factors does one bring in to make that explanation? And what causal pathways does one begin to develop in order to create that explanation? I have absolutely no doubt that the brain is of crucial importance in relation to the development of mental disorder. But what I would say is that in many, perhaps even in all of those conditions that we call mental disorders, many of the originary factors, perhaps many of the key factors, lie outside the brain. They lie in the relationship between individuals and other individuals. They lie in the social circumstances of those individuals. They lie in the situations of stress, anxiety, and conflict that people are placed in. And then those pathways through complicated processes, very complicated processes, obviously move back through bodies and into brains. My concern then is, if you have a kind of explanatory system which begins with the brain, which starts with the brain and then says it is from the brain that we can account for all these disorders, whereas I think a more ecologically valid way of thinking would be to say, in what way do these social factors, which I think one ought to be much more precise about, these social factors, but in what way, what through what pathways do these social factors shape the neurobiology, which in itself shapes the way in which the human being enters into interactions with others, which feeds back. So we're not talking here about an either-or situation. And I'm perfectly aware that the advances in neurobiology have depended to a great deal on reductionism, and a good form of reductionism. Be as simple as possible, because only if you're simple can you begin to isolate the cause-effect relationships and so on. But there's a certain point when you have to realize that that kind of simplification is maybe insufficient to account for something as complex a human experience as a mental distress and mental disorder.
Okay, do you think the new developments in the brain sciences are changing the way humans understand themselves?
I certainly think that the rise of psychiatric drugs, drugs that claim to act on depression, drugs that claim to act on anxiety, are beginning to change the ways in which human beings think about that distress. Over the 20th century, human beings began to understand their distress in psychological and psychodynamic terms, in Freudian terms, and think about repression, think about all the trauma, think about all those things that we know from that kind of psychodynamic vocabulary. To some extent, it's become possible now for people to think about those kinds of conditions as biological conditions. And you do hear people saying, oh, it's my neurotransmitters. I've got to eat more chocolate because it's got serotonin in, which is good for my neurotransmitters and so on. The penetration of these languages into everyday life and how these languages become the descriptions under which you live by and through which you make your world and your experiences make sense to yourself. That's what I mean by becoming a neurochemical self. Mm-hmm. The extent to which these languages from neurobiology are beginning to reshape the narratives that we make of our lives. In the same way as in the 20th century, people were persons with an identity and with a psychology, now we see persons with a mind, with an identity, but also with a brain. And people are beginning to think of that mind-brain interaction and how you can take charge of your brain, improve your brain, work on your brain, go to the mind gym, etc., etc.
So in your talk, you mentioned that individuals now are faced with an obligation to recovery. Can you expand on that?
Recovery started off as a radical critique of the idea of cure or treatment or something. It said, look, I don't necessarily want to be cured. I don't necessarily want to be treated. I want to be able to define myself what I need to be able to live a life. And if I'm living my life with my voices, if I'm living a life with my depression, if I'm living my life with my highs and lows, I just want to be able to live a life. But now, in the same kind of way as with empowerment, people are kind of obliged to recover. And obliged to recover means you're obliged to live a life. And what does it mean to live a life today? It means to be in charge of your money. It probably means to have a job. It means to have housing. It means to be independent. It means to have choices. It means to be on Facebook. It means to do 100 different things, all these obligations today. So in a sense, recovery has the potential, and I think we can see this in some way, to be a kind of process of normalization, where recovery means, from the professional's point of view, demonstrate to me that you can live what I take to be a normal life. And I think those people who are arguing for normalization did so for the best of all possible motives. They didn't want learning disabled people to be subject to stigma by whatever their, however their behavior was seen by others. But I think the obligation to recover is linked to a reduction in the tolerance of our societies for difference, and the belief that there is only one proper way to live your life, and if you don't live your life in this way, if you're not autonomous, if you're dependent on someone, if you need care all the time, if sometimes you don't want to go to work, if a couple of weeks you just want to stay at home and not talk to anybody, well, that's pretty pathological, and you've got to be brought back to being in a normal way of living. So that's what I mean about it becoming an obligation to recover rather than perhaps a toleration of the many different ways in which people actually do live their lives.
What is the role of diagnostic manuals?
As we move through the history of the diagnostic manuals, the diagnosis became more than merely a classification for organizational purposes. It became something that had to have a single neurobiological basis. And you see this very clearly in the arguments around the development of the diagnostic and statistical manuals. I think this is a really problematic thing, and I think people now realize it's problematic, partly because any classification, depression is actually a dimension rather than a category, partly because so many of the classifications that we have are comorbid. What does comorbid mean? It means that, you know, you've got ADHD and you've got anxiety and you've got depression. So I think we are at a bit of a crisis point in understanding what we want our diagnostic manuals to be for. But I think it's unlikely that these anxieties from people like me are going to lead to everybody thinking, okay, right, let's tear up the DSM and start again. But it might mean that we could perhaps do something alongside the DSM, which might be a little bit more helpful.
We had a long discussion yesterday about biomarkers, and you were obviously worried about the search for biomarkers now that it's really pressing.
The problem is that if you have a reliable indicator at an early stage that a person has a very high likelihood of developing a disorder, and if you have a treatment that has a very high likelihood of interrupting or even curing that disorder with few side effects, then who would argue against early diagnosis and early intervention, especially if the consequence of giving you the diagnosis doesn't seem to stigmatize you? But in the case of psychiatry, I'm afraid we're not in that situation. We don't have clear early indicators that demonstrate with any high level of probability that a person will develop a condition, only that they have a slightly elevated chance of developing a condition. We don't have any very good treatments that don't have large numbers of side effects. We don't have good evidence that intervening early in most cases will actually forestall the condition. There are a few exceptions to this, but we don't have very good evidence for that. And we know that the application of the psychiatric category has the potential to be stigmatizing, especially if it is for a child, because it will alter the child's view itself, the parent's view, the doctor's view, and so on and so forth. And it may well push the individual down a certain career path.
So Nick, thank you very much for your time, for your answers to my questions, and see you soon.